pitch or anything. So what do you guys want to do? Do you want to just ask questions and chat? And that'll open up a bunch of, that will open up topics, obviously. Or if you want to throw out a topic or whatever, we can talk about that. I can give you a little bit of history about me first, you know, and how I started this and my background and how I got into it. Does that sound good? Cool. So I always hate to say how long I've been doing this because I feel like I'm like elderly all of a sudden. But so it's been about 12 years, I guess. And I never really. And some people don't like when I say this. Some people do, but voice acting is not something that I set out to do. It wasn't something that I said, you know, this is part of what I want to be, part of my acting career. I did set out to do voiceover stuff, and mostly from a commercial perspective, because at the time I was in college and I was getting doing theater, which I still was a very, still a part of my career. And I thought, well, you know, and I've always come from this career from a business perspective too. It's like theater, it's not gonna make me a ton of money. It's not really good. It might make you no money, you never know. But so I thought I'm gonna focus on voiceovers. And mostly I was thinking about commercial voiceovers at the time because those are really lucrative, you know, it's really competitive, but you go in and you're there for 15 minutes and they give you some bunch of money and it's great, right? And I thought, well, that'd be a good way to supplement my income. So I trained voiceover-wise in front of a mic. I put together a demo, all that kind of stuff, while I was in undergrad. And then I went out, you know, I graduated and I started doing mostly a lot of theater stuff, some on-camera stuff. And then the anime thing just kind of happened. My agent knew that I was interested in voiceover stuff and I was going, you know, auditioning for a bunch of commercial stuff. And then I got a call from them and they were like, you have this audition for this thing called Orphan. And I was like, okay, I don't know what that is. And okay. So I went to this audition and I had no idea what I was doing. It was back in the day when it was like an actual hard copy script instead of, you know, now we do it and it's a sideways screen with a scrolling script and the animation is on another monitor. So this was like old school music stand with like paper. It's the weirdest thing in the world now, but it's weird to say that paper is weird, but it's natural, it comes from the trees. So yeah, that happened, and it was like, okay, yeah, so you got the role of Orphan, and it's 50 episodes, and I was like, okay. So that was my, and I haven't stopped doing it since. And, you know, at first it started as, okay, this is great, this is a great part of my acting career. And now it's something that I'm really, you know, really interested in. It's something that is a part of, you know, a part of my career in a way that it's something I really care about. And I've gone from that to doing motion capture work for several of the cartoons that I then voiced later. So that was really interesting too, especially from a stage acting perspective, to be able to put an actual some physicality to a voice, to a character that. So I did Briarios and Appleseed, and I did Ex Machina first, and they really liked that cast, so then we went back and redubbed the first movie. And then, I don't even know, well, so then I went and did some motion capture work for that, and I was able to, after doing the voice, able to put like physicality to it. So it was really interesting. Like as an actor, you know, if you're working on stage or on camera where your body is a part of that, you that's something that you have to think about. Physicality is very, very important. It's actually more important than dialogue. So it was interesting to have created a character only vocally and then have to figure out how to put that into my body at the same time. So, and that's interesting too about voice acting. People think it's about, oh, I do great voices, or I do impersonations, or I can make funny sounds, or whatever. And that's not, those are great things to be able to do. But the thing that I learned about voice acting that always stuck with me was, what does the person look like? How do they walk? What do they move? What's going on in their eyes? Is there a smile? Is there, because you can't just put some random voice to a character. It's got to seem like it's coming from that person, you know? So, you know, people talk to me a lot about, or I always get questions about, what's the difference between voice acting and regular acting? Regular is a bad word, but, you know, or on camera, stage, whatever. There are technical differences, you know? But I always say that acting is acting is acting is acting. Like, you can. And some people are better at one thing than the other. Or their, you know, just their skill set or whatever is works better for one of those things. But it's still gotta come from a place of truth and all that, and physicality is a part of that. So yeah, that's how I got into it, and I continue to do it for 12 years, and while I do, I lived in New York for 6 years, East Coast for 7 totally, and did some on-camera stuff, some soap stuff, some television stuff, theater stuff. So I always wanted to be that actor who was diversified, you know? And it's hard to do that because the business wants you to be really pigeonholed into one thing. And you do have to be specific, you know, about what you want to do, but it's been nice to be able to work and use my gifts and talents across different genres, you know? It's exciting. But that's how I got here, basically. Like, let's questions. You guys have questions? Oh, you got a microphone.
That's awesome. I would like to go first.
I mean, I can keep talking, but I think questions are cool.
So you recently reprised your role as Briarios in Funimation dub of Appleseed 13.
Right.
Do you think you might join your Houston colleagues who go to Funimation on a regular basis and do some work there?
I think so. I hope so. It's interesting how that happened because Monica Rial, you guys know Monica, right? We've been friends from Sentai for a while, you know, and I reached out to her and I sent her an email and I was like, hey, you know, I really want to start doing some work with Funimation and is there anybody you can introduce me to up there and all that? And she put me in touch with someone and that kind of got the ball rolling. And then they got the Appleseed series title. And so it worked out perfectly because they asked a bunch of us to reprise those roles. So yeah, and then I just did another, I think it was maybe 20 episode series with Funimation too. I don't know if I'm allowed to even say what that is, but maybe I should check somebody about that. Anyway, but yeah, so the answer to that is I hope so, and I've already done another thing with Funimation since then. So yeah, I hope so. Yeah, I like working up there a lot.
I'm a pretty big fan of your character in Sandlot's Memories, but playing Har, I know he's kind of an unpredictable character.
In Sandlot's Memories?
Yeah.
Because unpredictable characters, it's hard to... I wouldn't say it was hard. Yeah, it's challenging because you have to figure out why you're doing what you're doing. You don't always have to know why you're doing what you're doing, but you have to know, you know, in the journey of any character, or the journey of, you know, whatever the writer has written art-wise for that character to go through, you kind of have to figure out, you know, how did they get from one place to the other? Like, what happened to them? What is the impetus for this happening? Why is this guy making this choice? So yeah, it was, but I love those kind of challenges. So, I mean, that's what makes it fun. When there's a character who pretty much stays the same, or it's flatter, or, you know, I enjoy all of it because it's what I love and it's what I love to do. But yeah, it was, I had to figure out, okay, how did we get from here, from this to this? You know what I mean? Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You seem like you have a follow-up question on that. If not, no worries.
I'm not sure, I just really love that character.
Cool, yeah.
Cool.
Awesome, thank you. was great. It was great to come back to that story. It's funny that that show is just, Chris Harris and I were talking about that last night. It's just such a special kind of show. I mean, you know, it's just those four people, what they go through together, and the fights, and the laughter, and the connection. But we were talking about we need to get a panel, like just a Sayuki panel. You know, I think people have been trying to do that for a while, and I know, and they haven't been able to find everybody or get everybody together or schedules like that. But we need to do that. It should be like an event. Like we should figure out whatever convention it should work at, be at, and like make that the thing.
Yeah, right here.
Yeah, Boston's awesome. I love this. I've never been here before. A lot of places, but never been to Boston. Anyway, so, yeah, you know, you can tell when you even bring that up, there's a smile comes on my face just because there's something special about that. It was interesting coming back to it, you know, because of, and I don't even know why this happened actually, but you know, we did it and then there was another cast for whatever that other show was, and then fans got really mad, and so it was cool to come back to and revisit that, and just be back in those characters, you know, because it's like something where, you know, that was a while ago that we did that, and to be able to figure out too, and you know, a lot of the times when there is something like that, the animation's a little bit different, sometimes the script is a little different, or it's told from a different vantage point or a different point of view. So you have to kind of figure out, okay, this is the same character, but is this person in the same place in their life? Is it before or after the series? You have to figure out those kind of circumstances stuff in order to really play the role and figure out where the person is and what they're doing. So there was a little bit of clunkiness, and it's like this too if you're doing a very, a character voice for something where you really are in a different part of your range, or you're doing an accent, or you're doing, you have to refine, you know, even when you leave, you say you do a 4-hour session and you come back a week later, you have to refine where that lives in your mouth, where it lives in your resonance. And sometimes it can take like an hour to really, you know, an hour of a session, 30 minutes of a session to really land back into the right place, you know? But yeah, it was great to come back to it. I wish there was more. Yeah, it'd be fun. Who's next?
Just a small question.
Yeah,
sure. How did it feel being on Law and Order?
man, it was crazy. You know, television is really weird because it's, you know, in theater, you know, the rehearsal process is for the actor and for the playwright and for the director and all of that. And, you know, coming from that being my basis, my base or my foundation of acting, when you get on, and then on the opposite side of the spectrum, anime, there's no rehearsal at all. Sometimes you don't even know what the story's about when you get to the studio to record. Someone will hopefully tell you what's going on. And if it's something you've done before, obviously you know the character and all that. So, and then in television, when you audition for television stuff, they want to see what it's going to be like. And they won't say this to you, but they want to see what it's going to be like when you're on the set. So they really want a performance. They don't want to go, you know, with theater, they see somebody and they say, okay, well, he's great, he's got the right looks, making great choices. And we can, if he's not quite here for something where we need him to be, we can get there in rehearsal. In television, it's like, no, there's too much money on the line, we don't have enough time, you better give me the performance right now, and if you can, and you're the right look and all that, then you'll get the role. So I get that role. Actually, I auditioned for something completely different for that episode. And like a day before, they're like, yeah, you're gonna be the doorman. And there was another scene in that episode too that got cut. And that's the other thing too, is, you know, you get paid for your work, but you may not end up anywhere on camera, anywhere in the thing. But so such a funny story that you asked about that. It was a crazy experience. It wasn't crazy, but it was just, it was like the third or fourth thing that I had done. And so the rehearsal on a television set is for everybody else but the actor. The rehearsal, they call it a rehearsal, and they say rehearsal, and it's for the lights, it's for sound, it's for the director, it's for the camera, mostly for the camera. So you better know, you have to know your stuff. So I get there at like 6 a.m. I go to this trailer. It's on the Upper West Side in Manhattan. And I sit in this trailer all day long. I think I fall asleep. And finally at like 5 p.m. that evening, they call me. It's time to shoot your scenes. So I'm in this doorman outfit, right? And we walk into a building on the Upper West Side where we're shooting it with an actual doorman. You know, like, you know, a working doorman. And he looks at my costume and he's like, dude, we don't wear that stuff anymore. So I'm in like this velvet cap. I mean, you know, it was fine. It's, you know, it's not real, but it was just funny that here I am walking next to this real doorman and he's kind of like shaking his head at me like, that's the worst costume I've ever seen. Like, people haven't worn that since 1970 or something. So that happens. I'm like, okay. And so we go and I'm standing in front of that elevator to shoot the first scene, and it's a surreal experience because you have to learn, and this is a really bad thing to say to anybody who wants to be an actor, but you have to kind of learn to be able to act with yourself for television and for anime. I mean, you're acting against a Japanese voice that you don't always know what they're saying. So I'm up there, they call rehearsal, we do a rehearsal, I run through the lines. The director is like 30 yards to my left, and the guy that that's in the scene with me is this guy who's up, this big guy who's up on another floor, right? So I never met that guy. He shot his part of the scene, I shot my part of the scene. I think we did meet, but we didn't shoot those things on the same day. So I'm reading that scene with like a grip, like a PA on the set. He's like 30 yards that way, like around the corner. And so it was interesting. It was fast. It was fast paced. But I had to learn to like adapt on the spot. Like, oh, you mean I'm not gonna be reading with the guy? Oh, you mean the director's gonna be screaming at me from around the corner? I'm standing on. I wasn't. Somehow they wanted me to be taller. I don't know why. It's not like I'm short, but they had me up on like a crate so that because of the shot, they wanted my face to be closer to the numbers or something like that. So you're on this crate. It's the most non-realistic thing ever. Like, it's so fake. And a lot of television is that way, you know? What we see is not fake. And that's why the rehearsal is not for you, it's for the camera. It's all about the camera, it's all about the shot, you know? So yeah, it was a cool experience. It really was, that's great. I'm glad you asked that. Anyone else? So you record it separately, right? But there will be something in the animation that looks kind of odd, like it looks funny, that could mean another thing. And so we'll record like a fake line because it fits with something in the animation, which is not about the story at all. Usually it's something like terribly gross or yeah, some sexual innuendo or something, exactly. And, you know, so, and it's happened to me, and I've done it to people. You know, so then the other actor comes in for their scene, and they're reading, they're all into whatever character, and you just take them completely out of it. Some crazy thing. But I can't think of anything. Actually, someone did it to me just at the Funimation And I'm trying to think of what it was, but usually it'll be something like Matranga quit sucking or whatever. Like, or we'll give no notes to that. Really, you're gonna read it like that? That's the worst thing I've ever heard. But with a lip gloss or, you know. So that can be really funny and fun, you know, especially when you know the people that you're working with, which happens a lot for me at Sentai since I've been working there for so long, but up at Funimation, I don't know. I just met Micah, who was in the show that I just worked on at Funimation, and it was like, and this happened to me about 8 years ago with Shelley Black. We did Orphan together, and we were at an audition for some commercial. I think it was like a Texas Lottery commercial, that's what it was, which is, I'm really glad. Most of the time I audition for commercials, I'm glad that I don't get them, because I mean, the money can be good, but they're just weird and stupid, and I'm not a good person at selling stuff, so I never book them anyway. But I'm sitting at this commercial audition, and this girl's talking next to me, and I'm like, I'm like, that's, and she's like, are you? And we heard each other's voices and recognized each other, and I was like, oh my god, that's like old home week, we don't even know each other. But that just happened with Micah. He was like, I was just in this show that we recorded. And I was like, no way! It's all exciting and fun, but it's crazy that we don't ever meet each other, you know? Only the directors know all of us. So, it's a lot of fun, though. The booth is fun. It can be fun.
I was
going to
say, that's a great
happy
way to meet
you. Thank you. It's so good to be here.
One of the series that actually got me into anime, and seeing your voice pop up again up for a few years, it's almost like having an old friend.
That's awesome.
Really did put down to earth voice. It's like something you could have heard anywhere, but you've got the talent to make it work.
Right.
I just want to find out, what brought you here? Like, excited to have you here, but what can we do to make sure you keep coming back?
You know, thank you for saying all that. I mean, all of that is, you know, that's really astute of you, that comment. You know, when I was getting into anime, I thought, well, you know, the first role that I did was Orphan, and that was, you know, a teenage sorcerer kind of guy. So, at the time, that was 10 years ago, you know, my voice has changed a little bit since then. It's gotten deeper. I've been asked to do more gravelly, darker, deeper stuff. Like Starship Troopers to Briarios to a couple other things that I've just done. So I thought to myself, I want to just comment on this because I think what you said was really smart. I thought to myself, you know, where does my voice sort of fit in anime? Because I don't have like the Jason Douglas boom or the David Wall like booming, thick vocal cords thing, but I don't have like Chris Ayers, you know, that lighter, can play like a school kid, you know, which a lot of anime is that. And that niche of just kind of there's some quality to my voice that is really relatable, there's a connected feeling to it. And so I do end up getting a lot of introspective characters that are maybe a little tormented or trying to figure out what's going on with them, or
Sanzo.
Sanzo and Clannad, like that whole journey was just like, you know, at the beginning of my anime career, I thought, well, this is gonna maybe be something that I won't have a long shelf life because of that. And it actually ended up being the opposite, that I can do stuff from like major stuff to just smaller stuff. But since your second part of that, a couple of years ago, I was like, you know, I really want to start connecting to people that are watching this. And I was getting messages similar to what you said about, you know, hearing someone over the years, it's like you feel connected to them, all that kind of stuff. And I didn't know quite how to do that. And I'd been so busy before with other parts of my career that it wasn't feasible to really do many conventions. So I went to Greg and I was like, Greg, I know you like have been to every convention that's ever, you've probably been, you've probably probably created your own convention and went there. I went to Anime Vegas that way, and I wanted to start reaching out and really talking to people and seeing like, what do you like, what do you not like, what's worked for you that I've done, what hasn't, you know, because really it is about fans, it's about the audience, and it's about people that watch it. That's why we do it. That's why we tell any story, really. I mean, so when Anime Chris got me involved here. He gave them my name, and so I want to keep out. I'm going to send a follow-up email already and say, hey, I really enjoyed it. And this is the first day, but literally, I'm having such a great time talking to people. It's so well run. It's awesome that it's so big. Let me figure out what more I can do. You know, because when they approach us to do a convention, they're not sure whether we want to be heavily involved or just, you know, on the peripheral. So they kind of give us just a little bit. And I'm going to send an email and say I'd love to do a panel on, you know, voice acting versus on-camera stuff, or the business of voice acting. Or so I hope to come back. Let's send somebody an email, too. You guys let people know, because that will help me come back, too. Yeah.
Oh, yay. I was just wondering about what would happen if Sanzo intimately had to take a female into the party. Like, what would happen?
Take a female into the party? I don't know what would happen. What do you think would happen? Yeah. I don't know.
Would Sanzo be like badass?
I mean, I think he would be. He's kind of a badass. Like more done, I think he would be. Yeah, I do think he would be. I love that character. I don't know. We should open that question up to the audience. Everybody. Now you're getting to do a lot of stuff. You just feel like a respect.